start off. Thanks for this morning. So I'm going to talk about some of the developments that are emerging in respect of biological research in the mesentery. Mesentery is that structure that connects the intestine to the rest of the body. Our understanding of it has been inaccurate over the last 100 years, largely because it was thought to be a fragmented, complex structure made up of multiple separate parts. That's not the case now. This is what we regard as the mesentery now. I'm going to play this on. Okay, so this is how we now understand it. It's a single entity. It's not made up of multiple separate parts. It's one structure. If you dissect it and dissect the peritoneum, you see the structure, you can unfold the structure. It's about 2 meters in length and 1 arch, so it's a substantive, truly enormous structure. And it has a beginning and an end. Point in between. So it's very much different to what we've been taught over the last 100 years. And this really only emerged in the last 4 years, the true shape and the nature of the structure. So now that we have a better understanding of its shape, then we can actually begin to study it systematically and scientifically. And the systematic study of any structure is the scientific structure of that particular structure. So we now have an emerging field of science. We have opportunity for innovation. Innovate in respect of the basic sciences, and we can innovate in respect of the clinical sciences. And what I'm going to talk about this morning is divided into 3 parts. First, I'm going to talk about the innovations and the applications we have for fundamental sciences, anatomy, histology, and rheology, and others. And these really are the building blocks of all the applied sciences, so obviously very, very important. Secondly, I'm going to talk about the innovations that are possible as a result of the clinical sciences and how we adapt our fundamental findings with respect to clinical applications. And then thirdly, I'm just going to develop the concept of where we go in the future as well with this area. So firstly, on to the fundamental sciences and anatomy. You might think, well, I'm sure we know all the anatomy already, and remarkably, we've had findings in the last 4 years that have really blown open this whole field. So, as I said, we now recognize the true shape of the structure, or organ, if you have. And we now have to reappraise all anatomy that we have. It's related to every sensory position, it's related to the fascia underneath the peritoneum, the liver, stomach, spleen. All of these organs actually develop their biological limits. The advantage of that is that because everything is related, they're all in contact. So we'll have a lovely network of claims that we can approach from a surgical perspective or an anatomist who can dissect and we can take the body apart in the exact same manner that she was put together first day embryologically. So there's a lot of scope for innovation in anatomy. And as I said, we now have to reappraise all the done anatomy in the context of this particular structure. What about histology? This is the building blocks of structure, the individual structures that comprise it. Remarkably, there has never been a histologic study of the mesentery. Incredible when you consider it's at least 2 meters long at one particular margin. There have been some studies that have touched on it, but none that have focused on it. And it's remarkable really because when you consider the intersection between the intestine and the mesentery is at least 2 meters long. And that's the intersection where the body interacts with the intestine. So the whole zone where the body and the intestine interact is over 2 meters long. And this is it. I'm sure if the laser, not a laser from work. So this is the mesentery here, this is your intestine, and that's the interface. And this is the scanning electron microscope. There's your intestine, there's the mesentery, and you can see the interface. And if you look at disease, you see it's very different. It's Crohn's disease. This is your mesentery here, this is the intestine, mesentery down here, and the intestine. And you can see how the mesentery comes from inside to outside, from outside to inside, from above the intestine. And this is heresy. Gastroenterological and the surface perspective. The concept of Crohn's or fat causes to arise outside the intestine. But that's what we get to see, and I'll show you some evidence to support that shortly. But importantly, this zone, this region of interaction between the intestine and the mesentery is entirely uncharted from a scientific and from an investigative perspective. If we know structure, then we can understand embryology. We now have a new anatomic endpoint in which embryologists and developmental biologists have to work in order to actually understand the structure of the mesentery. start to do that, you see some really truly remarkable things. These are images taken from the fetus, about 40 days old. The light blue is the mesenteric part of the intestine. And we see that there are developmental processes beginning to happen that we didn't anticipate. We see that the mesenteric intestine is beginning to adopt a spiral conformation. So the bottom line here is that we have an enormous field for innovation here as well, because the anatomic endpoint that we have to work towards, that embryologists and developmental biologists are working towards, is radically different from what we thought in the past. So what about function? Well, we saw the kind of spiral nature that was being developed embryologically in the previous slide. This is it in the adults. And if you can imagine, if you just took an overview of your abdominal anatomy, you'll see your small intestines in the middle, the right colons on the right, and transverse on top, and the left on the left. So it has an overall spiral conformation. That spiral conformation is maintained as a function of the spiral conformation of the mesentery. So the mesentery holds the intestine in a particular position. It also keeps your intestine when you're in a dark cavity, the reason why it's flat as I am. But it also maintains connectivity with all the systems of the body, so your neurologic, metabolic, immunologic, and endocrine systems. And this places it in a very central position. So if you can imagine this, the intestine is the mesentery, and here you've got the rest of the body. Then what you'll see, increasingly we're seeing, that the mesentery signals or samples the intestine, and then it orchestrates systemic signals, systemic events in response to those signals. So for example, we're seeing that the activities or the signals that come from the intestine are regulating the mesentery. This then attracts various immunologic subtypes to the intestine, and then it regulates immune responses in there. We're also seeing changes in atherosclerosis and various other conditions, which we'll come back to shortly, among the senses. So, there are the fundamental topics, anatomy, histology, and biology. Obviously, these are going to have major implications from a clinical perspective. I'm just going to touch on these briefly. We're going to talk initially about radiology, diagnostics, then gastroenterology, then surgery. And you begin to see how the change in the anatomic radiographies that we have, the model that we have, is providing us with perspectives in all of these various sciences. So firstly, innovation in disease detection is radiology. Radiologists in the past approached abdominal imaging along the classic age of the fragmented mesentery. Now radiologists have to reapproach all of abdominal imaging with the idea of capturing the continuous mesentery. So we've done this, we've done it with a number of collaborators across the country, and we've generated an atlas by which radiologists can actually go back to real life, all CT, all MRI, all ultrasound, and can actually reappraise all of that imaging based on this new concept of anatomy of mesentery. In addition, we're seeing advances in ultrasound in the application of ultrasound. So if you combine ultrasound with gastroscopy, which we're doing all upper GI surgery, you can identify different components of pancreas and the gallbladder endoscopy. We have to identify the mesentery as well. This is the wall of the intestine. This is the mesentery here, you can see it tapering out. And so the advantage of identifying the mesentery at endoscopy means that we can follow a trajectory that would be less painful for patients than doing colonoscopy. The other key advantage is we're able to identify lesions such as this, which is an abnormal lymph node, but in the mesentery. Just like you biopsy the prostate transrectum, we could actually theoretically biopsy the mesentery and biopsy the abnormal lesions in the mesentery, just by combining ultrasound with colonoscopy. So this is an area that we chose. The next is gastroenterology. I'm a surgeon, gastroenterologist, refer on to surgeons. As we have a new anatomical frame of reference, we have a new perspective, so we new ways of looking at the interaction between the mesentery and the disease. This is the mesentery you see in a Crohn's disease. This is a specimen where a patient had an idiopathic resection for advanced Crohn's disease. Now you can see quite clearly the mesentery changes from normal to abnormal in an abrupt transition. This hasn't been documented in the past, but it's currently under consideration in the gut, and we've just received very favorable reviews in relation to it. But if you open up that specimen and look at the mucosa, the inner lining, what generates it, you'll see the mucosa actually changes almost completely entangled with the mesentery. So this suggests that the mesenteric and mucosal abnormalities are very, very tightly coupled. And if they're tightly coupled, then could that be because the mesentery is involved in the disease? One way of checking this is to divide the patients into two cohorts. You could take two patients in which they have lower resection when the mesentery is left, and then you can take patients one more done that. We've completed the study just recently, and as I said, received relatively favorable reviews on it. So the top panel there is the traditional resection of the open intestine, the mesenteric disease, the high flush of the intestine, and that's the typical specimen. The bottom panel is what we do with cancer. If we just apply that to Crohn's disease, we take out a lot of mesenteric disease. And this is the kind of result that you see. This is recurrence-free survival. So in other words, the higher the level of the bar here, the better the outcome for the patient, the less recurrence they have. And you can see from the top right cohort B, we've had one single patient who got reoperation from Crohn's disease over a period of 5 years. It's one out of 43. Whereas if you look at patients who need the mesenteric left, then approximately 35% of those patients will require reoperation. So clearly there's some elements and some activities in the mesenteric that are actually causing a progression of the disease. So what about intestinal surgery? As I said, we have a new anatomic model, we have a new anatomic frame of reference, we have a new perspective of looking at different things. We've shown anatomically that everything is in contact with the continuity and continuity, that we can actually start to separate out all of the structures along the embryological planes in a very assured and very safe manner. And because you can do that, you can then begin to try apply and converge mesenteric approaches with other types of approaches in surgery. We've recently installed a Da Vinci XI robot in the University Hospital London, and we've started to pioneer intestinal surgery, robotic intestinal surgery in Ireland, in Bishop. And what we've done is we've combined the technology and the techniques available through robotics with the new principles and the new anatomic requirements in terms of mesenteric surgery. So, what are the prevention benefits? So, the line here basically refers to length of stay. And this is one of the messes that were. This is their length of stay after robotic surgery when you combine it with mesenteric principles in operating on the intestine. And our length of stay is on average about 4 days post-resection. These are patients undergoing major resections. These are the length of stay that you see in other institutes around the world. So you have the Cleveland Clinic here, you've got the Mayo Clinic there, and the blue bar is laparoscopy, the red bar is open prevention surgery. And you'll see that combining robotic and mesenteric principles, we're actually beginning to reduce post-operative stay and gender attention benefits for the patients. So clearly, there's a whole new area of research and innovation possible in respect to surgery as well. So where are we going to go from here? I mean, what we've had in the past 2 weeks, we've had surgery anatomy collide, we've seen a clarification of mesenteric structure, we now know the shape of this particular structure, and so the possibilities here are really endless. So one of the key possibilities that we want to explore is the notion that the mesentery actually contributes to the body in general, and systemically to the body. And one of the key concepts in respect to that is the concept of visceral and adiposity, fat inside your abdomen. Men tend to have more than women. This isn't a ceramic from Avoca, this is actually a 3D model of the body. So we've taken slices from CT and then we've generated 3D. The blue, yellow and the red occupies the space, that's your abdominal cavity, that's mesenteric fat. Okay. The lavender here or purple, whatever you have it, is fat underneath your skin, and this is stuff in the backbone of your abdomen. So you'll see that all the mesenteric fat really makes up most of the body inside. And that's visceral adiposity, the major contributor to visceral adiposity. Now, we know from the literature that visceral adiposity is the single greatest contributor to atherosclerosis, cerebral vascular disease, renal vascular disease, heart disease, peripheral vascular disease. We know visceral adiposity is a major contributor to diabetes, mellitus, and control, dyslipidemia, metabolic syndrome, and a whole range of systemic abnormalities. So if mesentery is a major contributor to visceral adiposity, and visceral adiposity is a major contributor to disease, then it's very likely that the mesentery also has a role in terms of heart disease and various other conditions. And we've just completed a study where we've looked at this. So what we have here on this line chart, on the y-axis you've got increasing mesenteric fat, on the x-axis you've got the level of coronary artery disease, single vessel, double vessel, triple vessel disease, coronary artery. And you can see quite clearly as mesenteric fat increases, the level of coronary artery disease that people experience also increases. Now, interestingly, if you take the other types of fat and look at this, we don't see a correlation with cardiac disease if you look at this. Similarly, we don't see a relation with cardiac disease. But if you do look at this, you are seeing a relation with cardiac disease and the actual extent of severity. So, is there a potential cellular mechanism that can underpin this? Again, just to suggest that there is. We know that changes in CRP and glucose are all linked with diabetes, atherosclerosis, hypertension, metabolic syndrome. But if you look at it, you'll see that visceral adiposity regulates its part of the smartest contributor to regulating CRP and glucose and all these. So now we're becoming, again, if you think even stronger, levels of visceral adiposity and mesenteric fat play a major role in the systemic metabolic syndrome. So, to just conclude, this is how we now understand the mesentery. It's not fragmented, it's not broken up into multiple separate parts, so we know it's one single continuous structure. Because we have an understanding of its structure, we can now study it systematically. A systematic study is a scientific study. We can study it in the fundamental sciences, we can study it with innovations in the clinical applied sciences, and increasingly, we're beginning to recognize that events inside that fat also have a major impact on systemic events and possibly on systemic diseases such